International first. This spiritual institution was set up by Param Pujya Papa Swami Ramdas and Param Pujya Mataji Krishnabai on the 15th May 1931. At the time of inauguration, Papa made it very clear that the ideal of the ashram is to spread universal love and service based upon the vision of divinity in everybody. For the vision of divinity in everybody, a three-way method has been suggested to us based upon his own experience, and that is Naam, Dhyan, Seva. Whatever is happening only by God's will. Whatever is happening is only for our ultimate good. He is the indwelling and all-pervading reality. Papa names it as the mysterious power. And so to remember him, he is behind our every word, every thought, every deed. He is behind all the varied manifestations. So intellectually first we try to understand, and in our journey towards him, to the realization. The most effective method, Papa suggests, is chanting of his name. Any name of God is all right. What is expected of us is to chant the name with total faith and devotion, number one. Number two, with the feeling that we are chanting the name of one who is seated within. And number three, who is making me to chant. So from the superficial level, from the lip level, from the surface level, we gradually try to go within. So Nama chanting. Every one of us will not be able to do the Nama chanting throughout our waking stand. At best, because God has also given us various preoccupations like family, profession and society. So how do we ensure remembrance of God's name during the non-chanting time? There he prescribed the seva attitude. What is seva attitude? When we handle everything, right from the moment we get up from the bed till we retire to bed, whatever we handle in whichever field he makes us to do, there should be a touch of love, a touch of dedication, a touch of gratitude, and a touch of perfection. Because everything is a form of God. So intellectually, when we start accepting it, what, right from the tiniest to the grossest, we will try to keep up this attitude. Because when we come from the mother's womb, we don't bring anything, anything. Whatever that makes our life vibrant, with the air we breathe, with the water we drink, with the earth on which we stand, exist, with the space in which we move, the 98.4 degree temperature that keeps us alive, the sun, all these things are not brought by us, but for which we cannot exist also even for a second. Through Mother Nature, whatever is needed for us, you know, keeping up the balance of five elements, food articles, medicinal, everything is provided by Mother Nature. Then through society, he is there in the form of life force, he is there in the form of awareness, he is there in the form of intelligence absolute. Because of that intelligence, whatever that is made available by the Mother Nature, first it is discovered, in some cases it is invented, and then innovated. which are all, we call it as creature comforts. So that which enables us to live, that which enables us to live comfortably, both are provided by Mother Nature and society. So when we handle everything, if this aspect is writ large in our mind, we will be able to handle everything with a touch of love, with a touch of gratitude, with a touch of dedication, and with a touch of whole-souled mind. That's called perfection. Papa doesn't divide, he is not in favor of dividing the life between worldly and spiritual. Everything is spiritual. Because the spirit is there, no? Wherever we are, Pujya Swamiji today in the Gita talks, when he was making a mention about the 4th in the 10th chapter or something, he is there all pervading. So when he is there all pervading, whether I know him or not, whether I recognize him or not, whether I adore him or not, whether I ignore him or not, in certain cases, whether I deny him or not, he doesn't leave me. So this constant awareness through handling everything, this is called seva. And then, whenever, during past moments, let us try to do manana. How does the whole mechanism works? In fact, Papa gives us the clues that there are so many things which we are not doing. The at present me in us, which is arrogating everything to itself, which is feeling the sense of doership. There are many things which are not in its domain. Just like the heart beats, the blood circulates, the breathing goes on, the digestion goes on. All these are not done by the so-called me. And bereft of this, I don't exist. So the introverted journey as to who really am I, the core of my being, in whatever method is possible, we should do that. That is the third one. But in the seva as well as in the dhyana, what really helps us is the nama. For example, when we keep on chanting his name, not necessarily vocally, there are three types of chanting he recommends: vocal chanting, silent chanting, mental chanting. Vocal chanting, all of us know: Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, or Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Om Namah Shivaya, like that, Om Namo Narayana, whatever. The second one is silent chanting, where the sound will not come, the lip and tongue will move, a little more subtler than the verbal. And after sufficient practice, we may be able to graduate ourselves to mental chanting, where the sound will not come, lip and tongue will not move, but we will chant and we will hear. Initially, the mind may not cooperate with us. So immediately when the mind goes out, we open and restart. In other words, the chanting helps us to serve as a fence, preventing the outgoing tendencies of the mind, and when it has no such tendency, it has to turn inward. Then slowly this mental chanting will enable us or pave the way for the emergence of the witness consciousness. That means who is chanting, who is observing, and the chanting stops. It might be for a fraction of a second, but he has given us a glimpse of it. And then we will start getting stabilized. Since we are not full-timers, majority of us, we are under the guise of so many things, under the banner of so many things, you know, we are involved in various activities. Naturally, therefore, there is every likelihood that we may be under the influence of the three gunas. Our old baggage is also there in the corner of our mind, like likes and dislikes, rights and wrongs, preferences, priorities. So that may come and disturb us. Here Papa suggests periodical retreat, periodical solitude, and also periodical evaluation. Just like in schools and colleges, exams are conducted to check up whether we have assimilated the textual knowledge, and without the aid of the text or the teacher, we are supposed to answer the question based upon the assimilation of the theme. Similarly, we would have heard, we would have done so many practices, but what exactly is the store within us? That has to be very often checked, because we are dealing with men and matters every day, and we still feel that they are men and matters, not forms of God. So until we reach that stage, Pooja Swamiji was telling, you know, from the individual level to a little higher level, then we start seeing it in a positive method. Grumblings and complaints will not be there. So we are moving towards the goal of the fullness, the peace, the bliss. So these are all the three ways Papa has suggested. On the top of it all, the main thrust to be given is subservience to that higher power. Samarpan, surrender. He used to say emphatically, surrender is not a verbal assertion, not a mental exercise, but it is a state of experience. We may say we surrender, but no. And in his life, till 1920, he was leading an ordinary life, and God made him to go through successive failures to give him the necessary prompting to turn inward. And at that time in 1920, through one of his articles, we came to know that he happened to see Mahatma Gandhiji in a place called Mangalore, where he was there at that time, at a distance. But he says that was the moment he saw Gandhiji at a distance, he said that was the first spiritual touch. And thereafter he switched over to Khadi, started chanting Ram, Ram, Ram. Gandhiji was a great votary of Ram Nam. And Gandhiji's Ram stands for the universal consciousness, the universal truth. Not merely limited to the personal aspect, normally we call Lord Ramchandra Murthy, but also the impersonal aspect. So Papa started chanting. He was passing through stressful period. Mounting liabilities on one side, the creditors were pestering, his establishment was struggling to exist. He was also not leading a very happy, harmonious grihastha life, family life. So he was passing through the most stressful period. At that time, he was prompted to read texts like, you know, Bhagavan Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's teachings, Swami Vivekananda's teachings, Swami Ramtirtha's teachings, and to top it all, Yoga Vasishtha. It was not a merely reading. Yesterday, Pooja Swamiji was reminding us, reading and hearing will not help. It should be supported or coupled with, followed by manana and nididhyasana, recollection and contemplation. Deep, deep, deep. So with all this background, Papa was able to, in the shortest possible time, realize the indwelling reality and also slowly the all-pervading reality. Finally, God prompted him to sever all the so-called worldly ties on 27th December 1922, and then fully relying on God and God alone, left on a itinerant program. Absolutely nothing, a couple of dress, that's all, a few books. And he traveled from south to the extreme north. To him there was no stranger. That has been beautifully brought out in the first book, In Quest of God. It gives us a lot of messages. So when one is thoroughly established in it, there is no negative approach. Everything is positive because everything is God ordained. And it cannot but be for good. So throughout the journey, he was reveling in bliss. And he was able to identify the all-pervading reality everywhere, and in everything, and in everybody. After a few days of his travel, he was blessed to have the darshan of Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi that prompted him to go for a 21 days retreat, solitude, and immediately after that he was able to go and embrace anything that he saw. The light was there. Anyway, so that is how the journey ended, and he came back. There is a cave. Even now the cave is there in Mangalore. Even today we people will find it extremely difficult to go inside. There he was there. And then again he went on tour. Somebody took the initiative of compelling him to stay in a place called Kasaragod. There they put up a small cottage, and he was leading a blissful life there. People started knowing a blissful Swami is there, so people started seeing. At that time, Pooja Mataji, who became a widow in her early age, 20th, and that has shattered her whole thing. And with two children, she was passing through also a severe, stressful period. At that time, her late husband's brother, he was a doctor nearby, and they came there. So in order that Mataji would get some solace, they took him to Papa. They took her to Papa also. The moment she saw Papa, she knew, my father, my mother, my guru is this. That is how we are all calling Papa, Papa, Papa. Mataji started calling. And on the same line, 2.5 years, Papa himself says, her spiritual progress was something like a Sputnik. And she could scale the heights. Heights where there is no otherness. Absence of otherness. And God willed that they move from the cottage. And this ashram was set up in 1931. This is the brief history about Ananda Ashram. And people when come to know of it, they come here, stay for a few days. Nothing is imposed here. Papa is very particular that everything should blossom in their own way because everyone is unique. His one famous quotation is, be the light unto yourself, and in your own original way bring out the magnificence that is stored in you. So everything is facilitated here. Each one can develop and bring it out according to one's own Swadharma, स्वभाव। In 1963, Papa dropped the body, and then Mataji was the spiritual and administrative head. She dropped the body in 1989. Pooja Swami Sachidananda Ji, who was Ananta Shivan in his Purvashram, joined ashram in 1949. He had the great privilege of serving Papa for 14 years, and the privilege of serving Mataji for 40 years. So when Mataji dropped the body, though initially everybody felt their absence, all the devotees were able to see Papa and Mataji in Pooja Swamiji. And Swamiji dropped the body in 2008 in their Samadhi Mandirs. Morning 6 to evening 6, half an hour gents, half an hour ladies, they keep on chanting Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Though Papa has said any name is all right, probably for the sake of uniformity, if everybody chants their own mantra, there will be utter confusion. So for the sake of uniformity, what is being chanted here is Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. And this mantra also stands for both the personal, impersonal, and both and beyond. Papa himself has defined Om stands for the impersonal aspect of God, Sri stands for the personal aspect of God, Ram stands for both and beyond both, Jai stands for victory. Victory to that reality who is without name, without form, who is with name, with form, who is both and beyond both. So this is being chanted in the main shrine, we call it as Bhajan Hall. There the program starts at about 5 o'clock in the morning, goes on till 12:30. Chanting will be there, bhajan will be there, aarti will be there, prayer will be there. And because of the COVID now, only evening program is there. This is in brief about Anandashram, founding saints and the routine. The message is to come out of the me to me and then to move towards me to we first and then we to him. So these are the three stages through which spiritual graduation takes place. First from me to we. We are all in the me to me stage. Anything we relate ourselves from the individual plane. So we have to go a little higher. Knowing that everything has been provided by him and he is there in everybody as the life force. So I can't limit myself to me and mine. I cannot even exist for a second with me and mine. Me to be, I need in the form of nature, in the form of society, in the form of everything. And this is the same attitude of every living being. So slowly the circle of love expands. We call it as we try to lead a value-based life, which is nothing but me to we. And then later on, through Naam Seva Dhyan, we have been promised that we will be able to move from we to him. We were also asked to say a few words about Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Papa used to make a mention about Bhagavad Gita. There have been umpteen number of commentaries on Bhagavad Gita. All are valid and all are right. Because they look it through a perspective. And they have not merely knowledge. It's an experiential revelation. That is why every commentary is inspiring to everybody. But at the same time, the indwelling reality keeps on motivating us to plumb deep within and to bring out new dimensions. Today we will share a few thoughts of Acharya Vinoba Bhave, He was the, we can say he was the disciple of Gandhiji. He was an authority on all our scriptures. Whenever Gandhiji wanted any clarification from the scriptures, Vedas, Upanishads, Srimad Bhagavad Gita, anything, he used to refer to Vinobaji. When Gandhiji selected him as the first individual Satyagraha movement, in the freedom movement, and when he was jailed, his co-prisoners requested him to share some thoughts on Bhagavad Gita. And in the local language, every week he used to share. Somebody was kind enough to jot down, transcribe, and then more than 25 to 30 languages it has come out. It's a small book, Talks on Gita. It is not sloga to sloga commentary. It is the quintessence of how he perceived from, or how, what he derived from each and every chapter. But it is connected with our workaday life. That is the beauty of it. We will share how we were attracted. In the first chapter, at the end of the chapter, he says, Arjuna, when he handed over the reins of the horses, has already handed over the reins of his mind. And that is why the Lord gave him, when he was passing through delusions, uncertainty, and lack of clarity, and he was dispirited, dejected, and he sat down, I will not fight. From that stage, Lord Krishna started giving him the wisdom teachings. And at the end of the 18th chapter, he did not impose. He gave him the full freedom. Yathechasi tatha guru. Whatever you feel like, now you do it. The ultimate, it was given to us. It is a wonderful message. But because he has assimilated what has been taught, he was able to immediately give back the freedom he was given. And then he said, Karishye, whatever you say, I will do it. So he says, when Arjuna has handed over, the doubt may come to you that for Arjuna there was one Krishna. To me, who is there? So Vinobaji says, don't limit Krishna to the historical person. Krishna is there at the indwelling self. The moment you hand over the reins of your mind, Krishna will talk to you in your own language and he will lead you to victory. This is how he starts the first chapter. And the end also is beautiful. So we will read a few portions. The first and foremost purpose of Srimad Bhagavad Gita is to illuminate for all of humanity the realization of the true nature of divinity. At a personal level, Gita is always considered to be a perennial source of insight and inspiration to solve all the problems of life. More or less, it is a manual. Talks on Gita by Acharya Vinobaji unravels its essence in simple, candid, relatable manner so as to enable a common man to efficiently deal with his umpteen daily challenges and hurdles. Gita is undoubtedly a treasure of self-knowledge. If you explore it deeper, you can gather many precious gems to enrich your life to its fruition. This booklet, we are trying to bring out a small booklet, because even Talks on Gita is a book, probably we may not be having sufficient time to go through. So again, it has been distilled, made an attempt. So the first chapter, Vinobaji reveals Lord's clear assurance to show us the path to the fruition of life if we hand over the reins of our sense of individuality, the mind, to the Almighty Lord Sri Krishna, who is none other than our true nature, that is inherent in each one of us in the form of life force or awareness. One should know the sense of individuality is the root cause of all problems. This is the second chapter. That is centered on body, mind and senses. The second chapter shows that self-knowledge is needed to know that this is not our true nature, the body, mind, intellect complex, no? And reveal the science of a sthita prajna, a man of steady wisdom who has attained self-knowledge. The immortality and invisibility of the self, the perishability of the body, and the inevitability of sadharma are the major themes discussed in second chapter. And the third, no one can live without having any karma. The third chapter shows that one has to convert karma into karma yoga in order to rise above sense of individuality. I am the doer, no. I have been made to do, yes. The fourth chapter explains that vikarma is the process of expanding karma. His definition of vikarma is different from the traditional one. Fifth chapter deals with, is enjoined with vikarma, results in the absence of sense of agency. In other words, it becomes sahaj, natural to us. Even when we may be doing action, but we are not conscious of it. It becomes so natural for us. Just like when we learn the driving, after we learn everything, and when we do the driving, all our sense organs are working, but it comes by itself, it becomes sahaj. According to the sixth chapter, if karma has to become vikarma, that means a specialized karma, inward journey and consistent practice are necessary. Seventh chapter points out, we can identify the common factor in the varied manifestation, though apparently different from each other, which perplexes our mind. Here he says, you know, the same artist, on the same canvas, with the same brush and paint, brings out different caricatures, which evokes different responses. When it is known that one's life is not to be limited to me and mine, but is meant to experience the presence of the common factor, God, what is needed is to develop good samskaras to attain self-knowledge. This is the essence of the eighth chapter. Here he says, you know, at the time of leaving this body, what should be the provisions we should be carrying? It should be good samskaras. So at the time of leaving this body, we must be able to remember him. For that, we have to keep on practicing right now itself. Otherwise, that will not come. Unless and until we are free from the cravings and desires and so many other downpulling forces or tendencies, we will not be able to remember. Vinobhaji stresses this. At the time of death, what should well up in our mind is only the God dimension. That is called the good samskaras. Life becomes fulfilled when constant God remembrance is there. According to 9th chapter, Nama and Seva are helpful for God remembrance. Here in the case of Nama, he says, it is a right royal road, highway. You can close your eyes and run. There won't be any accident. That means Nama chanting helps one to carry on. No other sadhana is necessary, provided it is done with the right perspective. Then along with the above, in the 10th chapter, effort should be made to feel the divinity in all creations, different types of situations, behaviors, characters, pairs of opposites. This is the essence of 10th chapter. First we learn simple letters, then combined letters. First we see God in Rama. Then we should see in Ravana too. Initially it may be difficult for us to see him in the so-called labeled negative things. But he says, we should develop this so that first you identify with the positive which you have named as positive. And later on you will see that negative and positive are the different facets of his own. Then the 11th chapter. Seeing the divinity in all means, we feel we are all instruments in his hands. This is what the 11th chapter highlights through Vishwarupa Darshan. 12th chapter reveals the signs of a true bhakta. There you know in 7-8 shlokas, the Lord defines who is my real bhakta. Swami Ranganathanji used to say, we may say that I am the bhakta. No, he should say that he is my bhakta. So how to qualify myself to become his bhakta? Those have been beautifully brought out in the 8 slogans there. Adhyeshta sarvabhutanam maitrakaraneyavaya. And in this particular chapter, Vinobhaji takes pains to elaborately discuss about the personal and the impersonal aspect. Normally when we go to a temple in India, you know, the temple worship is there. The idol is there. Normally, you know, we give a name and form to it and call the chosen deity or Ishtadevata. We all think that is the personal aspect. But Vinobhaji says that is the most nirguna aspect of God. Because the idol stays there untouched, unmoved, unruffled. Even if we offer, it doesn't take anything. Even if we ignore, it doesn't bother. Next day I come, okay. It remains untouched, unconditional. So he says, the nirguna aspect is more there in the positive aspect. So like that he elaborately discusses. So that there will be clarity. We don't belittle the importance of personal aspect of worship. At the same time, we don't limit ourselves to the personal aspect of worship. Papa used to call it as impersonal person. We equally worship a personal form with the feeling that it is the manifestation of the impersonal aspect. So he elaborately discusses in the 12th chapter. And in the 13th chapter, he explained the gradual transition from the personal to impersonal, the body level to the knower of the body level. And the 14th chapter, how 3 gunas overpower us and how it prohibits the sense of individuality to itself. So transcending this is a must for spiritual progress. Gunatita. 15th chapter. Unless and until we see the God remembrance behind every thought, every word, every deed, spiritual progress is impossible. He says it is like a tripod. There are only 3 things in the world. Beautifully explains this. Me, the devotee, he, the Lord, within and without, and rest of the things are articles of worship. Me, the devotee, he, the indwelling spirit, and rest of the entire things available before us is the article of worship. So this should be the attitude. He said spending about 5 minutes or a half an hour or 1 hour in puja room alone is not enough as far as Gita is concerned. He calls Gita as mother. She will be satisfied only if we stretch the same attitude to the entire activities of our life. These 3 are, which are unavoidable. Dedicating everything to God, harmonious blending, knowledge, love and action, based on the developing of a proper relationship with the Lord and all objects, they should go on simultaneously. 16th chapter cautions that one should be alert, then only one will know whether all the actions are an offering to God. many of you might be knowing this, that he lists about the values, avayam, sattva, samshuddhi, there are about 24. And here also Vinobaji says, there is a captain there, you know, fearlessness, that is the first captain. And the last one also is that you should be very careful, namrata, vinaya. Puja Swamiji was telling, you know, unless and until we develop this, not that we develop this, we naturally grow into that. When we become subservient to the entire, to that power, the sense of individuality becomes less and less dominant, and it realizes, you know. So, namrata. So, it starts from fearlessness. So, the front portion is fearlessness, and the back is humility, so that nobody else can enter this. Beautifully explained. There are about 24 values above. And then 17th chapter exhorts us to dedicate everything as an offering to the Lord, so as to expand from individual to universal level. Here he talks about how do we replenish what has been taken out by us from three institutions. He names it as two institutions and then the body. Mother Nature, society, and this body. So he defines anything that we are all eating, you know, we are all taking so much from the Mother Nature. So we have to produce any productive activity, creative activity is the yajna. Anything that we, you know, we share, whatever we have gained through the society, dana, and whatever we have taxed on the body, mind, it is tapas. So yajna, dana, tapas has been given a beautiful meaning. Everyone has, because we are replenishing what has been taken out from the nature in the form of yajna, what has been taken out from the society in the form of dana, what has been taken out from this body, mind, and complex in the form of tapas. So this has to be there. Over and above, the unqualified and total surrender to God will alone result in the individual becoming one with the Lord, which is the ultimate success of his life. This is the essence of 18th chapter. Lord, through these 18 chapters, removes doubts and confusions welling up in the mind through discriminative faculty and analysis. Finally, Lord gives the freedom to act as we wish, surrendering ourselves totally to him. Based on his teachings, the freedom given by the Lord is offered back to him. Thus Gita teaches us that he is the only reality and we exist only because of him. The state of jnani will be attained wherein connection with the body is completely severed. This state will be three-dimensional. In the state of activity, wholly pure and perfect activity will be done. Pure activity. Selfless. Absolutely selfless. In the state of consciousness, a sense of agency will be there, yet will remain untouched, unaffected. In the third state of jnana, he will not allow any action to touch him and burn down his actions. We should try to free ourselves from the responsibility of all our actions. We should know that we are an insignificant creation and an instrument in his hands. Try to know actions are body-centered. Always try to know that you are Shiva, not Shava. And finally, he closes the word. The ultimate sign of spiritual progress is one becomes zero. Everything happens only by his will. Everything happens only through his institution and instrument. Every manifestation is also he. So we as a separate individual cease to exist. This is how he brings out. Because there are about 700 stanzas in 18 chapters, it will be very difficult for people like us who are involved in various activities to remember all the seven understands us. But when we try to go deep within, in a mysterious way, Mother Gita will take us to a few shlokas where we get aligned within. And that will get stamped in our heart. And the more we think about it, it will lead to some other sloka. Then finally we come to know, oh. For example, he defines yoga, dexterity in action, you know, efficiency in action is yoga. Equanimity is yoga. So when we parade our own life experiences, wherever we have been given a patting on our back by our boss, by our elders, you have done well. We try to think what has happened in us. We try, the me and mine was not there. Entire efforts were pooled. So it came directly from the source. He is known as omnipotent and omniscient, you know. Sarvajna and Sarvashaktiman, Sarvavyapi. We see all these words, omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. So everything is stored here. So when the me and mine, for a moment, when it steps out, this stored faculty, stored capacity, capability, it comes out and it expresses in the form of perfection. That is yoga. That means God is directly doing it. Papa used to say in one of his quotation, how much time?
10 minutes.
There is no need for an intermediary. Somebody wrote to Papa that you should pray for us. So Papa immediately replies, it's a very, very thought-provoking word, sentence. God does not need an intermediary. If you think Ramdas can talk through, God can talk through Ramdas, he can talk through you as well. Because you cannot accuse him of partiality. Switch on your wire for direct communication. Why do you deny him in your heart? God does not need an intermediary. If you think God can talk through Ramdas, he can talk through you as well, because you cannot accuse him of partiality. Switch on your wire for direct communication. Why do you deny him in your heart? So we have been asked. That is why we learned that he did not go through any of the traditional methods. Yes, before we close, we would like to share that even after scaling the heights, Papa was able to maintain a mysterious relationship. His own words are, though Ramdas and Ram are one, Ramdas would like to be the Das of Ram, the child of Ram. So he was able to maintain that relationship, and it comes out in the form of dialogues. So Papa asked all of us to have a daily chat with him. Don't worry, even if it is for 1 minute, half an hour, 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Daily we chat with him so that we try to feel closer to him first. And when we develop this nearness, he says the next step will be, you will have a glimpse of his presence. And again, when we practice this, we will get stabilized in his presence. And then to see him in everything, in and around us. And finally, to become one with him. These are the four stages, he says, in the spiritual journey he could experience. So nearness, samipyam, sanidhyam, vyapanam, ekatvam. Nearness, his presence in him everywhere, and finally to become one with him. So these are all some of the things which you wanted to share. And we have been fortunate enough to get Pooja Swamiji here in connection with, you all remember, you know, on 27th December 1922, Papa, who was called Vittal Rao till then, took the leap and he became Swami Ramdas. So this 27th December 1922 is the end of the centenary. So this December 27th, yesterday, and to the next 27th, we have the centenary period. We were prompted. Anandashram does not involve itself in celebrations as such. Pooja Mataji was not in favor of any celebration. So here, we have been prompted to take an in-depth study of his first book, In Quest of God. Initially, it may look like a travelogue of a spiritual aspirant first and a spiritually illumined soul. But for us, it is, apart from this, it is also a manual for our life. Just like we call Srimad Bhagavad Gita a manual, In Quest of God also serves as a manual. Because it started, you have the text, no? The first line of the first chapter says, he was passing through severest test. The first line of the first chapter. For nearly a year, Ramdas struggled on in a world full of cares, anxieties and pains. It was a period of terrible stress and restlessness, all of his own making. That he makes it clear. From the individual level only this. In this utterly helpless condition, where is relief, where is rest? This was the heart's cry of Ramdas. The cry was heard. And then we travel. 37th chapter, with the last chapter. There at the end he says, Ramdas stays, by Ram's command, in a cave called Panch Pandava Cave, in the Kadri Hills, in Mangalore, and lives there a serene life. A stressful life in the beginning, and now a serene life, devoting his whole time in talking about, writing of, and meditating on that all-loving and glorious Ram. So when we are all passing through, you know, every one of us is subjected to face trying moments, challenges, commitments, duties, but not. So here there is an assurance to such a person. Ultimately, if he wants a peaceful mind, a serene mind, a calm and quiet mind, a contented mind, a blissful mind, what he should do. So all these 37 chapters give us some clues, some hints, you know. With that perspective, if we go through, otherwise it will be a travelogue. And he conveys this through anecdotes. So this 1 year, we are all prompted to take up an in-depth study, chapter by chapter, individually. Some thoughts should be shared every week to give a boost to us. So that by the end of the year, at least some of this, you know, at least a fraction of what he has, it might be revealed to us. Provided we do it in the same, with the same perspective. So it is for launching this. Pooja Swamiji came all the way from Rishikesh. And yesterday he gave us also the hints how to pick out from each and every chapter. One or two chapters he picked up. Just now we said, you know, the prayer was heard. How do you feel? On what condition? We all pray, you know. But our prayer and the real prayer is different. So like that, Swamiji gave us some clues also. So, with the blessings of all, we are praying to Him, the indwelling reality, who has motivated us to take up this in-depth study, to really eke out the maximum benefit out of this 1 year centenary Swadhyaya yajna. Thank you all very much for your patient hearing. And whenever God makes it possible for you to visit India, do visit us and give us the benefit of your presence. Hari Om. Thank you very much. Thank you.